has La Cucina Italiana now surpassed French cooking in the United States and abroad as the main focus for restaurateurs?
Well, you know, we know we have some restaurants in New York.
Yes.
We do have five restaurants plus two big catering halls. And what we're doing there, we're doing the real Italian food, you know. Unfortunately, not everybody does that. But we have a tradition here. We, you know, I'm the son of the man who started Harris Bar in 1931. And I've only been here 60 years. And we always believe in the cooking, which comes from the women, which is the cooking before the invention of refrigeration, when you had to bring flavor from food that was salted, that was, you know, smoked or dried or anything like that. And they really today, for instance, we have the bacalà. Bacalà is one of the main things of the Veneto. But the main cooking is actually the home cooking, which has, I think, the DNA of the whole world, you know. Because I think if you give sugar to a newly born baby, it will have it. If you give salt, spit it. It will the lemon, spit it. And this doesn't matter if it's Japanese or American or Italian or so on. So I think there is a general DNA about the taste of food. And I believe, of course, I'm Italian and I also talk for myself. And I believe that Italian cooking is the nearest thing to the world DNA in food. So that's why you can repeat it. I mean, you can have it today, you can have it tomorrow. In a different shape. I mean, you can have risotto. How many ways you can make risotto? How many ways you can make pasta, for instance? See, of course, first courses are the main object of our cuisine.
I was very captivated by what you said about Italy and what the perception is and what the truth is with the many small towns. Tell me about that.
Well, I think that cooking and restaurants, and it's not only food, it's also service. And what we are seeing around the world now, there is a tendency of service to be the same. I mean, you know, there's a robo service. I mean, look at the way they answer the phone, for instance, when you call the hotel. They say, thank you for calling so-and-so, and what may I do for you, and I'm Luigi, whatever. I mean, which is so unpersonal, the whole thing. And I think the restaurants in Italy are the trattorie. These are the real restaurants. And they can bring the culture of the place where they are. And Italy is so, I think, the only country in the world that has so many differences. You know, you have a small town, which is different from the other. And they have, you can imagine that Chioggia here, which is in the same lagoon, they have a different dialect from Venice. So, I mean, you know, they're different. And this is what I think a tourist should, or a visitor should, find the difference of the people, which is part of the cuisine, of course. You see, it is, definitely.
Tell me a little bit about the history of Harry's Bar.
Well, Harry's Bar was opened by my father in 1931. And he was, before he was a bartender at the Europa Hotel. And among the customers, he had a young American whose name was Harry Pickering. Was a heavy drinker, and one day, for no reason, he stopped drinking. And said, "So my father inquired, said, why don't you drink anymore, Mr. Pickering?" He said, "Because I have no money." I mean, he had no money, not even to pay the bill with the hotel. So my father lent him the money to pay the bill, to go back to the States. And 2 years later, Mr. Pickering came back with the money that my father had given him, with more money to open a bar together. So that is why it's called Harry's Bar, because of Harry Pickering, you know. I always say that if you had credit cards, then Harry's Bar wouldn't exist. You would have paid a credit card, because it was a rich family after all, you know. So this is the, and then the idea was to make a bar outside, like a hotel bar, but outside the hotel. So all the people from all the hotels would meet here. And there is another key about Harry's Bar, which is no imposition. So it has to do something with freedom. You know, freedom is no imposition, and we don't impose. You probably know this. We have small glasses like 100 years ago, and everything is not imposed. And that is one of the secrets, I think.
Daryl, we all know, anybody that knows Harry's knows that Harry's created the Bellini. What I did not know, what Daryl told me today, is this is where Carpaccio came from.
Yes.
I did not know that. Tell me about that.
But Carpaccio, there was a Venetian countess. It must have been 1950, and for some reason that I don't know why, she could only eat raw meat. I don't know what kind of illness she had, but she could only eat raw meat. And she was tired of having tartare all the time, so we started to slice very thin a filet to start with. It was a filet. And on top of that, we put a sauce, which we used to call universal sauce, because it was good for fish and meat. And then the same year that we did that, there was the Carpaccio exhibition, and every 2 years they had a Biennale, and every 2 years they had a Renaissance painter exhibition. So we saw that it worked with Bellini for the same reason, and we call it Carpaccio, and there it is. And then we don't make it with filet anymore, we make it with counter filet, you know, with roast beef, pasta, and which is more tasty in a way.
There we go.
Okay.
Perfect.
Right.
Uh-huh. Wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Grazie mille.
Thank you.
Very, very nice.